Thinking Liberty, episode 27.
Welcome to Thinking Liberty, the podcast that explores lifestyles of freedom-minded individuals. Join us as we discuss work, hobbies, health, learning, and more while living a travel-orientated lifestyle. Be curious, be open, be inspired, be free. And now, here are your hosts, Zach and Sarah Varnell.
Hey everybody, welcome to another episode of Thinking Liberty. We're coming to you from our makeshift studio here in our house outside of Atlanta. And as always, I'm Zach.
And I'm Sarah, and we have another great interview for you guys today. And I really think that this interview kind of embodies the spirit of Thinking Liberty. It'll be with Abby Lutis, and we'll go through her journey and her exploration and kind of walk through how she found opportunities and just kind of made travel a priority and made it happen for herself, which is really inspiring and really cool. There's a lot of inspiring things about her, and we'll get into that in just a minute. But before we do, just a quick update on what we've been up to. So one of the things that we love about the Atlanta area is that in the spring and summer, pretty much every weekend, there's some type of festival going on. So this past weekend, we made it out to the Inman Park Festival, which was a favorite of mine when we lived here, but we haven't been to in a couple of years as we've been traveling. So it was nice to get to walk around and check out the local art and some local music and just really, you know, be out in the nice weather that we have for the couple of weeks that we'll have it before it's unbearably hot in Atlanta. So we had a lot of fun doing that. And coming up, we're going to several music festivals. So hopefully this nice weather will hold out for those too.
Yeah, so I know this weekend too, I went to somewhat of a music festival, sort of a low-key thing called Sets at Sunset with a couple friends. And then next week we have Shaky Knees, which is a big kind of rock and indie concert. And I think like Queens of the Stone Age and Jack White and Matt and Kim and Andrew WK and some of our, you know, favorites like them will be there. And then the week after that weekend, we'll have Shaky Beats, which is an EDM concert with like, who is there? Kygo, Marshmallow, and a bunch of other acts that I can't think of right now.
Yep, we have terrible memories in case you haven't noticed.
Yeah, I'll look it up on like Friday before we go. Be like, oh, look, we got to see this band.
And we'll get excited all over again and be like, yes, I'm so glad I bought these tickets way, way, way far back.
Yeah, it's sort of like planning a trip versus actually going on the trip. It's like planning is half the, well, maybe not half, but it's a lot of the fun. Like you plan it, you get to like talk to your travel partner and like think of all these grand ideas of what you're going to do. And then you actually go and you have fun. So this is sort of the same for us, where every time we see who's going to be there, we get excited. Then we just forget about it and see it again and get excited again.
Yeah. So it's pretty cool. So our guest this week, Abby Lutis, she is an avid sportswoman. She actually attempted to try out for some of the Olympic Games. So we'll let her tell you a little bit more about that story. Pretty impressive and really cool. She actually tried out in response to a newspaper article that she found. So it's all about her like finding opportunities and pushing for them. And so Google has actually been pushing this article on me. And at first I'm like, I don't know, this looks kind of like a scam. But you look into it and it's actually pretty cool. This airline is, if you look at CNBC.com, they're reporting on an airline that will actually pay you to travel the world with a BFF or another person that you would like to join with you. It's the Icelandic budget airline WOW Air. And I haven't done any background research on this yet. So,
well, apparently they've done it before, haven't they?
Yeah, I think they do this. I don't know if they do it every year, but this isn't the first time I've heard about it. I think maybe 2 or 3 years ago. Mm-hmm. So if you have a lot of flexibility and you have a lot of like free time, these are the opportunities you want to look for and research for.
Or if you're just beginning in your career.
Yeah, and Business Insider reports on this. But the thing is it will take a lot of time because the guests will be required or expected to provide video blogs, Instagram stories, photos, other creative digital content that you can come up with to promote your travels. And by promoting your travels, you're promoting the airline. So that's kind of the key there. But they also pay you $4,000 a month, and it's for 2 months over the summer. So things like that are things like if you have kind of a cyclical job, like teaching, and you might have a couple months off during the summer, that would work. Or, you know, if you're taking a break between semesters in school, or, you know, taking a little sabbatical from graduating before you start your career. I mean, it's just kind of one of those things where it's like, there could be opportunities out there that you're just not researching and looking for. You know, you can say, well, I don't have the money to travel. Well, here you are. They're going to pay you to travel and promote your stories. And most people that travel love to promote on social media. So, you know, you're already doing some of this already. You know, the time thing could be an issue if you have, you know, a full-time job that you can't break away from. But, you know, it's just about what your priorities are. So it's just kind of cool, and it reminds me of Abby's story, because she was all about, you know, looking for opportunities, or somebody would bring an opportunity to her and she would jump on it. And it's just kind of one of those things, like you have to have that flexibility, you have to be able to go with the flow and be spontaneous to really take advantage of your travels sometimes.
Yeah. So it sounds like it'd be a perfect opportunity for somebody who's like just graduated college or just graduated high school and has an interest in marketing and writing and traveling, and they would get to do all of that. I mean,
you could use this as a experience for a future resume too. So I think that's really cool.
Mm-hmm.
I wouldn't want to be away from Ollie for 2 months though.
Yeah. So I guess the deal is you're flying Icelandic Airlines too. So you're going to be going anywhere they can go or that they do go, and writing about that and blogging about that. That's cool. Yeah, I've seen a lot of articles recently about airlines, because I guess after, you know, being on the road and traveling for like 2+ years, Google is just now figuring out that I like travel. So they're telling me all these travel articles. And
so they stopped giving you horror stories about RVs?
Yeah, for the most part. I haven't seen any of those in a while. Like, they knew I liked RVs for a while. So every article that came up about RVs, they wanted to tell me. But most of them were like, RV catches on fire on I-75, and or RV tips over due to high winds. Like, definitely not stuff that I wanted to be reading as we're driving around in an RV. But I've seen a lot of these articles about airlines where it seems like they're becoming more like budget airlines that you hear about or experience in Europe. Like, you know, I know talking to some people in the US, they are like, you know, why can't we have an equivalent to Ryanair in the US, where it's like, I get it, it's going to be uncomfortable, it's going to be super budget, I'm going to have to pay for extra this and extra that if I want it, but I want to be able to get somewhere cheap. And it seems like the US might be starting to catch on to that. And I know, I think it was Delta now, they have even more basic than economy. And I read that some airline now is even going to start discounting the seats in the very back of the plane. So, I mean, that doesn't sound fun, especially on a long flight. That sounds pretty terrible. Your seat probably doesn't recline. You're going to be like the last off the plane, and you're also probably going to have the least amount of luggage space and all that sorts of stuff. But if you're really on a budget, I mean, I'm glad that option exists.
The thing is that I've paid the normal ticket price and then been stuck in the back of the plane seat.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's right. I said that right. Where I couldn't recline and somebody reclined onto me and I literally had no space and I paid the same amount as them and the other people in economy. So, I mean, if you know, if you want to travel cheap and have that option, you know, it's it's better to save some money and be stuck in that seat than.
And it might be better now for the people who don't choose to go that budget option, because people who do will fill up those seats and you won't get stuck with them.
Yeah. So it could be a perk. I don't know. We'll have to see how it plays out. It is kind of interesting to watch these airlines all try to scramble to, at the same time, like Delta's rolling out this new
like first class seating,
special first class seating, where you have like a your own like privacy door and like all this stuff.
You basically shut yourself in a little cube, a little cubicle box.
Bigger than a little cube,
yeah.
And there's another airline that's rolling out a suite where basically you can lay down and go to sleep, like instead of just like the seat that kind of stretches out so you can sleep, it's like actually a little bed.
Well, it sounds like I guess the options are expanding both on the high end and the low end.
Yeah, I guess crazy.
Yeah, we'll have to see whether that is good or bad. I'm like, I think more options are usually good, but let's hope that, you know, the options in the middle don't suffer because of all this. We'll see.
Yeah, that's what I'm worried about.
Yep. But anyway, I guess that's about it for us. That's all of our updates. We got all these things coming up that I'm sure we'll talk to you about on upcoming episodes. And that's all the travel news, I guess, we've seen recently, what stood out to us. So let's go ahead and get into the interview with Abby Lutis.
So hi, Abby. Welcome to our show. We're really excited to have you on. We've been really looking forward to chatting with you. And thank you so, so much for your flexibility on this, too.
Yeah, thanks for having me on the podcast.
Yeah, of course. So let's get started with a little bit of background about yourself. So you're from Australia, and you said at one point you left and traveled abroad for 3.5 years. So tell us a little bit more about what inspired that and where you went.
Yeah, so I guess, as you just mentioned, I live and grew up in Australia. And growing up sort of through my teens and early 20s, I was an athlete. So I did a lot of travel around Australia with that. And I was fortunate enough to have pretty good talent in the sport of beach sprinting. So I did some travel mostly around Australia because this sport is really quite popular here in surf lifesaving. And then I was talent ID'd into bobsled, which is not really a sport that Australians do. So that took me off on a traveling journey to Canada, North America, and then over to Europe, where we were trialing for the Olympics in Turin in 2016. And so that was a really crazy, exciting traveling adventure, but was really mostly focused in sport and in bobsled. So we didn't actually end up qualifying for the Olympics, and I came back to Australia and continued on with my beach sprinting, which had been quite successful in and also represented Australia in that sport. But I was sort of in the traditional study type role, and was working in the city in Melbourne, and finally had got into a really, you know, almost like a dream role that I wanted. I was working in event management, and after being in this role for about a year, I realized that it just wasn't for me anymore. And so I was looking for the next thing. Was it to go on and do some more study, or in this case, it just happened to be travel. So I sort of took the leap of faith. I quit the job and I bought myself a ticket to Buenos Aires, and I practically packed up my life. And I told myself and I told my family and friends that I was going for about 6 months and then I'd be back to figure out what I was going to do. But I think deep down, I knew I was going for a longer journey than that. So I ended up leaving for 3.5 years, where I traveled through South America and then ended up living in Canada for a while. And whilst I was living in Canada, I did a lot of travel around the States and down to Central America. And yeah, that's my journey.
That's so amazing. I'm very impressed as someone who is not a very sporty person. So what is beach sprinting?
Well, essentially it's the same as sprinting on a track, but here in Australia, there's a popular sport called surf lifesaving, where it's a whole different type, all different types of sports that take place on the beach. So there might be swimming events in the ocean, paddling what's called a ski, which is kind of like a kayak in the ocean, and the running events take place on the beach. So it's just essentially a 90 meter beach sprint race, running for 90 meters across the sand.
That's really cool. How did you go from that to the bobsledding? Just, you said talenting in?
Yeah, so essentially in Australia, the sport of skeleton had a big talent ID program here, which skeleton is the sport. It's an individual sport where you sort of head first down the ice track on your sled. And what they found was that beach sprinters were really quite good at this event, because most of the skills come from the fast sprinting on the ice at the beginning. And it turns out that it was the same with bobsledding. And I think almost like Cool Runnings, if you've seen the movie, sprinters are very well suited to bobsled and these ice sliding events. So I did a few trials in, we don't have any ice tracks here in Australia, but we had a makeshift track and did a few trials here and then went on tour. So it was quite a whirlwind adventure.
What was it like being on tour and traveling with your team members and just exploring this new, I guess, sport and new adventure?
Yeah, it was absolutely crazy. It was a whirlwind adventure. As I said, we were sort of thrust into, I'd never seen snow before. And so for me, it was really different to go to somewhere that was cold and there was snow. And all of a sudden I was spending, you know, 24/7 with the athletes and people that I didn't really know all that well. I'd done a couple of months training with them. But it was, you know, a lot of it was focused on the sport. It was great to be able to go to new places and new countries and all of that sort of thing. But the focus really was on the training, and we did get to see, you know, some of the country and some of the places we were going to, but most of the time it was training and racing and competing. So yeah, it was quite fun.
So when you took off to Buenos Aires on your 3.5-year trip, would you consider that sort of a backpacking trip you did, or did you kind of just set up, you know, multiple home bases and kind of go off from there, you know, staying in one place after the other for a while?
It was absolutely a backpacking trip. I think I had 2 nights accommodation booked and I was really flying by the seat of my pants. And I wanted to plan and try and organize things before I go. But what I realized for me was I just travel so much better when I don't have any set plans. And yeah, I had a couple of nights booked in a hostel and I ended up living in Buenos Aires for about 6 weeks. We rented an apartment with some friends that I met in the hostel. And I had a couple of, you know, major places that I wanted to go to, like Machu Picchu and Patagonia and Iguazu. And like I had an open-ended time frame and I didn't have an open-ended bank balance, but I think that probably, you know, maybe stopped me and sort of led me up to Canada. But I really found that it was better for me to sort of follow my nose and really just meet the people. And I think when you're backpacking, you know, you often meet people and you hear of where they've gone or where they're going, and then it sort of sparks your interest in those places, and it's a really cool way to travel.
So when you went to South America, it sounds like you were kind of just doing that based off savings, and then when you got to Canada, you got a job to bankroll your travels that way?
Yeah, pretty much. So I'd saved up some money and because I sort of made this decision quite quickly, I didn't have probably as much as I wanted, but I had a stash in the bank and I'd had a pretty good job before I left. And so I had that, you know, chunk that I was going to travel with. And I thought, you know, when that runs out, I'll find a job. And so it was a combination, I think, of sort of feeling like I'd had enough of living out of a bag and traveling and unpacking, and a combination of my finances running low and just sort of the right timing for me to head to Canada to take advantage of the winter season that was coming. So when I landed in Canada, fortunately, I am also a remedial massage therapist. So I had those skills to be able to get that job, which was quite an in-demand job in the mountains. So yeah, it was really good for me.
So when you first arrived in Buenos Aires, was it scary or overwhelming not really having a sense of a plan, or was that kind of liberating and just allowing you to really just pursue whatever came up?
It's really funny that you asked that question because leading up to the trip, I was so scared and nervous to arrive in Buenos Aires in a country I didn't know. I didn't speak the language. I really was just so nervous and so scared, and I couldn't stop thinking about just that first instance, like, how am I going to get to the hostel, and I don't want to be scammed by anyone, and what am I going to do? And what ended up happening actually is, as we were flying into Buenos Aires, I think I'd been on the plane for about 14 hours, our plane started to turn around because there'd been a volcano erupt in Chile, and all the ash had gone over to Buenos Aires in Argentina. It meant we couldn't land at the airport. So we ended up going back to Chile, and we had to stay a night in a hotel there and then head off the next morning. And so what that meant was that we just, through all this drama, I made a couple of friends that were in the same situation as me, and everyone just wanting to get on to the next destination. We sort of forged together and worked it all out with the people, and we became, good friends in a short amount of time. And so when I landed in Buenos Aires, it was sort of, I had those people around me, and it was like, well, what are you doing? And we're catching a bus, let's go together, and you can do this bus or that bus. And, I got to the hostel and I sort of looked back, and I was like, what I was so worried about in the beginning, I had practically, blinked my eyes, and this situation had happened, and all of a sudden it was just not an issue, and it was actually quite a funny adventure.
Yeah, so you were kind of thrown into a situation where you had to adapt and be spontaneous and flexible, so it just kind of prepared you for the rest of your trip.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think because we were sort of caught up in the mayhem, everyone sort of bonds together a little bit more. So everyone that was on the flight was sort of like, we're going to go to the airport and just try and get a flight to Buenos Aires, when, we were being told that there wasn't going to be a flight until 2 p.m. the next day. And yeah, we just sort of made it happen. And yeah, it was that flexibility and adaptability to just figure things out.
Yeah, we spent about 6 weeks in Buenos Aires too, but all of ours was completely planned. Like, we knew exactly where we were going to be staying. And I like that sense of comfort in a way, but I do think we miss out on some of the more spontaneous things like you're talking about.
Well, we were also working, so we kind of had to know where we were going to stay and how we were going to work. And because we both work remotely. So.
And I think having planned trips can be really beneficial, especially if you are going for a short period of time, because you do want to have that structure and you want to be able to fit in the things that you want to see and do. But if you are sort of open-ended, the plans don't matter so much because you're not sort of set to a time frame.
So aside from just meeting people kind of going through the same travel struggles as you, did you have any other ways where you met friends along the way or travel buddies?
It put me in a position where I just had to get out of my comfort zone and just learn to make friends with the people that I was meeting on the way. And that meant just talking to people at hostels, just sort of going out and spending time in the common areas, talking to people on buses, and really just putting myself out there and seeing if that person was, someone that I liked and got along with. And often I would meet people that were on a similar traveling journey to me. And so, we might spend a bit of time together and then we'd go our separate ways and then we'd meet up again a couple of months later. And that was really quite fun.
So you said you spent all that time in South America and then you went from South America up to Canada, which seems like complete opposites. You went up there to kind of take advantage of the snow, but was it just for snow, or were you also inspired by people you met on your travels? Or
I don't think I've ever heard anybody say they want to take advantage of the winter in Canada before.
Well, I guess I had one of my biggest inspirations who led me to travel was my cousin, and she had spent time in a little town called Fernie. And I also had a friend who had returned to Fernie. She was living there with my cousin, came back to Australia, and then returned back to Fernie, and she now lives there. And she was there at a similar time to when I was thinking, you know, that I would move there. And everyone sort of said to me, Abby, get a visa, come to Canada and work, and you'll love the snow. And I was like, I don't know about this. I don't know. And so even along my travels, I was sort of still hesitant. I remember booking my ski lift pass thinking, I don't know if I'm going to do this. But my friend Kate, she was there, and she's like, I'll pick you up from the airport. I'll organize accommodation, a place for you to live. And I sort of jumped online and started finding work there. And as I said, like, I'd started to run out of money. So that was another driving force. And I wasn't ready to go back to Australia. And so all of that combined, I was like, okay, let's go and try this out. I'm into adventures. I like doing outdoor sports. I hadn't done much skiing or snowboarding at that point. And so I was excited to give that a try. And that was kind of the driving force that led me up to Canada.
Now that you're back in Australia now.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And you have some projects that you're working on that have to do with travel. So I think you mentioned expeditions for kids, and you're taking them traveling or something like that. Can you tell us a little bit more about that?
Yeah. So when I returned home from Canada, I went through like a massive reverse culture shock that most people do after they return home from living or long-term travels abroad. And I wanted to continue traveling. And so I wanted to find a way that I could do that and essentially get paid for it, because I came home with a little bit of debt. And so I was able to find a job where I was going to be leading expeditions with school children and secondary school children. So I kind of felt my way into that. I wasn't quite sure what it was going to look like or what it was going to turn out to be. But at the end of 2016, I led my first expedition to China and Vietnam. And the trips that we do with sort of 15, 16, 17-year-old school children, and we really travel in a backpacking way. So I work as the leader of the expedition, and but the idea is that the kids actually lead the expedition. So they have a rough itinerary of where we're going to go. We have some set things scheduled in, like a trekking in a remote area and a community project, normally in a remote village or something like that. But the rest is up to the kids. And so it's really about teaching them how to travel and how to budget and how to just get out of their comfort zone and, you know, try new foods and do all the things that they don't normally. And it's quite interesting to see them work through the process and lead the expedition themselves. It's quite good.
That's awesome. I wish I would have gotten to do something like that when I was that age. That sounds really great.
Yeah, it is. It's so good, because a lot of these kids maybe haven't gone away from their parents for that amount of time, or if they have traveled overseas, it's been in, you know, 4 or 5 star all-inclusive resorts. And so this really gets them out into the communities and kind of gets them to see what it is like to really travel in a developing country, as opposed to, you know, just going and staying at the fancy resorts that you kind of don't really get the sense of what it's like to be on the ground.
So what led you into this program and what drew you to it?
Well, I guess I just was looking for a way to travel. But when I found out more about the program, it sort of really aligned with my values in sort of the educational aspect of the way that they taught the children to travel, and the values that they had. So leadership and mindfulness and resilient. And I think that those things really aligned with, you know, my values. And so that was one of the reasons which I aligned with them, I think, and started doing it.
What has been your favorite country to take the children to on your expeditions?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think because it is such a hard question, you know, when people ask you what is your favorite country. But I think I probably have two answers for this. Vietnam is a really wonderful place to travel to, and the kids absolutely love it. But I think it's been really interesting to take kids to China, because China is so different in a sense that their language is so different. They don't even have, like, we can't even understand, like, their written language because it is in symbols, and their culture is just so different. So it is really a culture shock for the kids when we arrive in China and they've got to figure things out. And some parts aren't as easy to travel in as, say, Vietnam, which is set up for travel and it's really easy, and a lot of the time half of the people speak English. So I think when I've been to China, it's really helped those kids to grow and expand and step out of their comfort zone to, you know, to try new things and to, you know, go out on a limb and have to try new foods and all that type of thing.
So through visiting all those countries like South America and China and wherever else, have you picked up any Chinese or Spanish or anything like that along the way? Were you mainly able to survive on English?
I learned Spanish when I was in Argentina, and then again when I went down to Guatemala, I did some Spanish when I was in Central America, and I love that language so much. I studied for about 4 weeks when I was in Buenos Aires, and then when I went around traveling, I was able to practice my Spanish. And then when I went back to Central America, you know, a couple of years later, it all came flooding back to me, and I'm glad that I did another week's worth of learning the language at a immersion. I stayed with a family and did some schooling because I love speaking Spanish and being able to speak with the locals. I absolutely love that language, and I'm probably, you know, if I was to go back to the country now, like, all that would still probably come flooding back to me, because I think when you learn that the beginner level, even though you forget it, and here in Australia there's not many opportunities to speak Spanish, when you go back, the words start coming back into your head, and you can still, you know, enjoy learning the language. But in terms of Chinese or any languages in the Asian countries, I haven't dived into any of those yet. So I did learn Japanese in high school, and that country is high on my list. So perhaps that's one to come.
So you mentioned that you did a week with a family for immersion and schooling and learning Spanish. How did you go about finding that opportunity?
It was something that I was sort of looking into before I went down to Central America. And then when I was traveling along before I got to Guatemala, I found a few friends who were also heading in the same direction, and they were wanting to learn language as well. And so we combined forces and did our research together. I think there was about four of us that ended up going into the school, and we were all at different levels with our Spanish. And yeah, we just did the research and found a school. And when we got there, we went and had a look and made sure it was what we're after, and it was, thankfully. And yeah, it was a really great experience. We all got placed with a family. So we lived with the local for a week and went to school, and it was just a really nice experience to just really see how the locals really live, because it's quite different to when you go to a place and stay in a hotel or a hostel.
That's a really good idea.
Yeah, and I found that in Argentina, at least compared to, you know, when we visited Japan, it was a lot easier to learn the language. Because in Argentina, it's like, you know, we didn't really look any differently than them. So people just spoke Spanish to us like we were supposed to know it. But then in Japan, you know, everybody just assumes we don't know any Japanese, which is correct. And then they would be prepared to show us like numbers on calculators or point to stuff. Yeah. That didn't really happen in Argentina, so.
Yeah, and I think Spanish in some ways is a little bit similar to English. I mean, at least we can read the words if we know how to pronounce their alphabet. But I think, you know, some of the words are similar. So when you come to those ones, it's you're like, oh, this is sort of sounds like an English word. So it can be easy to apply in that way.
So about Guatemala, that's one of the countries that is on our list, or on Zach's list at least, to return back to, because we went there just for a day on a family cruise, which can be nice because it really gives you like a little sampling of a bunch of different countries. So what were some of your favorite things to experience or do in Guatemala?
Great question. I think Guatemala is one of my favorite countries that I've traveled to. First, I went down to Lago Atitlan, and that's where I did the immersion and the learning of the Spanish. And that was just beautiful because it's a really quite a big lake sort of set in a volcanic area. So there's all these little communities around the lake, and there's volcanoes all around the lake. And it's just, it is so, it
sounds
so
amazing.
Picturesque. And it's, I actually met up with my cousin there because she was doing a yoga teacher training course there. So it's quite a lot of people go there to learn or to just do a yoga retreat or that type of thing. So that was the first place that I went to. I then went to Antigua, which is a really cute little colonial town, and I loved it there as well. I was there around Halloween and Days of the Dead. So we went to this incredible festival. I don't know. Have you heard of Days of the Dead?
I've heard of it, but not too much in detail.
I've only heard of it in reference to the Mexican holiday, which I don't know if it's the same in Guatemala.
Yeah,
or not.
I'd say it's probably similar. So it happens, I think, either on the 1st of November or the 2nd. It's sort of around that same time as Halloween. And how they celebrate is they have a big kite festival in the cemetery. And so essentially, I guess what the, you know, behind, you know, the festival and everything, the idea is that they're flying the kites up to the spirits of their family members that have passed. But it's really quite a beautiful event because you go into the cemetery and there's people everywhere flying kites, and there's giant kites that have been made, and people sort of celebrating around, you know, their family members' graveside. And I guess it's just a really nice way to for them to connect with, you know, their family member that has passed. And it sort of makes the cemetery not be such a doom and gloom place, but more like a really happy celebration, and, you know, that their spirit of their family member is still living on. So that was a really incredible festival to go to, which we went to a little town just outside Antigua. It was, it was really cool. But yeah, Guatemala, probably one of my favorite places to go to was I went up to Lanquin and Samuc Champey, which is a really beautiful, I think probably when I was there, just starting to become touristy, but it's a beautiful natural environment where there's these limestone pools, and you might have seen pictures of it because it's just so picturesque. And there's a river that flows underneath, but these limestone pools are just turquoise blue and just surrounded by lush green cliffs, and it's just a really incredible setting. So there I was able to go caving and hike up to see these, you know, beautiful limestone pools, and then go down to swim in them and all of that type of thing. So yeah, it was just, I think that I just have so many fond memories of that day in particular, of visiting Samuc Champey. That's probably why you know, I just love Guatemala so much.
Well, that's really good to hear. Yeah, we'll definitely have to make it out there soon. So Zach will be excited.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Yeah, so I think you've provided a lot of inspiration for people to travel to all these places just through your great descriptions and, you know, your awesome stories. But I also saw on your website that you're a life coach, and that I think one of the things that I saw when I was checking it out is that you talk a little bit about finance and how people can, you know, help fund their trip, maybe, or I might be getting it wrong and I want to hear from you. But can you just talk about that a little bit and maybe provide you know, any inspiration or guidance to people who want to travel but are a little bit hung up on things like money or free time?
So I guess, so I'm a life coach and I work with people who come home from travel and then experience this reverse culture shock, or there's also another phase which is called the post-travel blues. And it's, I guess reverse culture shock is when you come back to a country or your home country and a lot of people or your friends have moved on and you've had this great experience and you just don't relate anymore. So I work with people who are working through that transition and but they know that there's something on the other side and they have an inspiring project or idea or want to get back into the career and jump on board with that. But I guess a lot of the problem is when people come home from traveling for an extensive period of time is that they have run out of money. So I developed a little program just to help people get back on track with their money situation. And it's sort of all about, you know, paying off your debt and sort of getting your money mindset right before you are able to sort of build back to a place where you're debt-free and perhaps getting rid of credit cards and all of that type of thing so that you can then launch into the next steps. But in to answer your question, if people are hung up on money, then I really don't have this hang-up because, you know, sure, if you're going to go and travel a five-star lifestyle, it is expensive. And myself being from Australia, it's expensive to travel anywhere, to get a flight anywhere, except if we're going close maybe to Bali or something like that, which I haven't been to. You know, getting a flight to, you know, to South America or to Europe is pricey as it is. And so I think if you're from, you know, any of the other countries, you're quite lucky because there are cheap flights. And I know if people are wanting to travel, I just recommend booking a ticket because there is nothing more powerful that can get you into that travel mode than booking a ticket. And then perhaps if you do want to travel, be prepared to go and backpack and stay in places that are very inexpensive and perhaps choose destinations that aren't pricey. I mean, I traveled to Panama and Costa Rica, and I remember in Costa Rica staying in great hostels. There was nothing wrong with them, and it was a great place to meet people. And we were paying $3 a night. So it really can be cheap to travel if you do it in the right way. And if you are wanting to travel and, you know, you're worried about finances, then perhaps look at some of the destinations which are quite cheaper to travel to. And Southeast Asia is the same. It's very cheap to travel in that country. And especially, I think if you are from a country like Australia or the US or Canada or Europe, you know, we're developed nations. And so look for those countries that are, you know, inexpensive to travel to. And to be honest, I think they're the most exciting countries to go to anyway, because they have such a difference in culture.
Yeah. And as far as flights, I know if you're here in the US and you don't really think of this, mm-hmm. but the flights aren't even that long to get to these you know, Central American countries and, you know, Mexico and things like that. It takes longer probably to fly across the US than it does to fly from, you know, at least where we are in Atlanta, Georgia.
Yeah, absolutely. When I lived in Canada, I was just wanting to go everywhere because I lived actually quite close to the border of the US, and there was an airport just across the border in Kalispell in Montana. And I would drive there and get cheap flights out to San Diego, and I flew down to Mexico and Cancun. It was really cheap to do that. The flights are short and they're cheap, and you know, like I think living in Australia, everywhere else is so far away. So I think that's part of the reason why so many Australians travel, because they're so curious to go to these places so far away. And, you know, I'm used to traveling 8 hours on a flight just to get to Thailand or, you know, Southeast Asia. So going, you know, 17 hours to get to Canada is you know, probably the longest that you go on a flight. But it's definitely something that's doable for me.
Well, your story is just so inspirational, inspiring. You're really making Zach and I over here be like, okay, we've got to get back on the road and get out there more.
Well, I'd love to have you here in Australia. Oh my gosh, you guys are doing some great things with your podcast. It'd be so great. And Australia is just such a beautiful country. I'm so fortunate to be here. And, you know, I want to travel more around my own country because it's so beautiful.
Yeah, of course. That's amazing that you have that mindset too, because I feel like a lot of people are just like, let's get out there and get far away. And, you know, everywhere else is better than where I am. But, exactly. You know, we've loved traveling a lot in the U.S., just getting to see the different states and the different landmarks and experiences. So it's cool to hear another fellow traveler has the same viewpoint about their own backyard.
Yeah. And I'm the same with you about the states, because I never really had any desire to travel there. But when I was living in Canada, there was so many places that I ended up traveling to in the states. It's amazing the things that there are to see, and still many more things that I'd love to go back to see in the states. Sometimes we neglect to look in our own backyard and we just think that the exciting things are far away, but they're actually, you know, there's exciting things everywhere. We just have to be open and look for them.
Yeah, that's so true. If you do make it back to the States, let us know and maybe we'll road trip out to wherever you're going.
Yeah, I'd love that.
So I also love how your story, you know, you became so passionate about travel and just getting out there and experiencing it. And then you took that and moved it into your career and your life now that you're back at home. So how did you find your job? Just through a job listing or through a friend?
Yeah, so with the expeditions, I was searching. I mean, I do a couple of trips a year, so it is very casual. And I've set my life up now so that I can be quite flexible and live a lifestyle that I want and actually enjoy the jobs that I do. So part of the reason that I wanted to find a job that would let me travel was because I love travel. And so I actually spent a chunk of time just searching online for expedition jobs or jobs that would allow me to travel. And then I just followed my nose into that. And then I became a life coach because I was really passionate to help other people. And now I'm, you know, diving into that area and working with people to really, you know, help them in, I think, especially here in Australia, it's not very common to have a life coach, and perhaps more common in the US. You guys pick things up a little bit faster than us down here. It's probably coming, but I just find it really valuable when you have someone to work with to help achieve your goals. I just wanted to help travelers and wanderlusters, because I know that they do go through that funky phase when they come home from travel and they're, you know, in that stage of what am I going to do with my life now? So I really love helping those people shine light on their goals and actually reaching them as well.
That's really neat. Such a cool story. And I love how at each step, you're kind of, you know, finding your opportunities and your inspiration and just kind of making things happen. So I know I'm jumping around here a little bit as we start to wrap up, but I'm going to take a guess here. When you were trying out for the bobsled in the Olympics, did you find that opportunity through research too?
Well, that was interesting. Because what happened was there was an article in the local newspaper, and my boyfriend at the time was like, you should try out for this. You're a sprinter and they're looking for sprinters. And I was like, oh, I'm not sure, but I'm always one of those people that initially sort of have that, I'm not sure about this, but then I always just think, well, I'm never going to know unless I try it. So, you know, there's no harm in trying something. And for me, it's really led me on these epic adventures and travel and sport and everything. I think if you take the opportunities or at least just try them on, because you just don't know what it's going to open up for you. And I found that with a lot of things that I do in my life. And I think, yeah, that's probably a good message to take away, is just to try. I mean, if it's not for you, you can always change.
So I noticed too that you have a podcast. So can you tell us a little bit about that and what it's all about?
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you so much for asking, Zach. So I started a podcast at the start of this year. It's called The Wanderlust Is Mind, and it's an extension of my life coaching business because I wanted to share the stories of people who go out and have this amazing traveling journey, and they learn so much. People learn so much from traveling. It's just fascinating to see, you know, how people grow after, you know, going away and living somewhere for a year or spending 6 months traveling around Africa or whatever it was. But what I really wanted to do was sort of showcase to people out there that they do come back and go through this transition phase that really sucks, and they're not sure what to do, and they've just had this great adventure, and then all of a sudden it's back to reality, and perhaps they don't relate to their friends anymore. But most of my guests then go on to do something quite amazing. So they might have set up their own business, or they've become a travel writer, or gone on to do, you know, something that is really fulfilling them in their lives. And so I guess the idea is to showcase those stories so that people that are going through that transition themselves and, you know, have just got back from travel and perhaps feel a bit down, that they can reach out and listen to these amazing stories of people that have actually utilized their inspiration from their travels and have turned it into something that they really love in their life. So I'm absolutely loving the podcast. I love meeting all the guests that I'm chatting with, and everyone's so passionate to share their stories. And I think something else that for me I was really passionate about because of my sporting background was just how important mindset is. And so when I was growing up, I applied a lot of that in a sporting sense as an athlete to achieve my sporting goals, but it really can be transferred across to any area of your life, really. And I've just transferred it across to travel and adventures. And if you really apply your mind, you can actually do whatever it is that you want. So that's the message that I want to get across with the podcast. And I'm really enjoying my guests and chatting to everyone and sharing their stories.
Yeah, that sounds like such a great resource. And it's such a good topic and good idea because, you know, a lot of people I know, they come back from traveling or experiences and they feel down or a little just empty, and they feel like, well, I shouldn't be feeling that way because I've just had all these amazing experiences. I mean, look at all my pictures and look at all my stories. But so it's good for them, yep, to know that it's natural and normal and that they're not alone. So that's really cool that you're providing this resource. So where could listeners find you?
Yeah, so you can find the podcast on iTunes. It's called The Wanderlust Is Mind. And you can find me at my website, which is abbylutis.com. And then I'm also on Instagram as Abby Lutis. And you can find me also on Facebook. I'm The Wanderlust Is Mind with Abby Lutis. So they're the spots you can find me.
Okay, awesome. Thank you so much. And for our listeners, of course, we will put those links on the show notes page to make it much easier for you. Yeah, so thank you so much for coming on and for sharing all of your stories and information with us. We've really enjoyed this.
Yeah, well, Sarah and Zach, thank you so much. It's really been an honor to chat with you on your podcast. I'm loving your episodes, and I just I hope you're getting the podcast out there to lots of listeners too, because it's such a great resource. So thank you so much for having me as a guest. I've really enjoyed being on your show.
All right. I hope you guys enjoyed that interview with Abby Lutis. I know I really enjoyed it. And going into this, there was a little bit I knew about her, and it was all interesting stuff. But she threw so much more at us that I had no idea that she was involved in. And it was just really cool to hear everything, like all the, you know, things that she's involved in and all the ways that she's made travel possible and the things she's done with her life so far. So like we mentioned already, if you want to check out Abby. She has her website. It's abbylewtas.com, and that's ABBYLEWTAS.com. And then she is the same on Instagram. That's Abby Lewtas. And also be sure to check out her podcast. That's the Wonderlusters Mind podcast. And you can find that at her website, abbylewtas.com, but it's also on iTunes. So I'm sure you'll be able to search for it on there and find it. And then while you're at it, be sure to check out Thinking Liberty. We don't have quite as succinct and nice social media names as she does. So ours is on Twitter and Facebook as ListenTL, which I think on Facebook you can search for Thinking Liberty at least. But also go to thinkingliberty.com. And if you haven't subscribed, please, you know, hit the subscribe button on there. And we have all the different ways that you can subscribe on iTunes, Stitcher, and just wherever else. You know, we're on YouTube, all sorts of podcatchers I can't even think of right now, but we're on them. So be sure to check us out there too.
And let us hear from you. If you have any comments or feedback or questions for Abby or any of our previous guests or even us, you know, just drop us a line and let us know. Leave us a review, send us an email, send us a message on Facebook. We're happy to chat. And yeah, maybe your questions will be incorporated into a future episode. So.
Yeah, especially the review part. We really appreciate that. If anyone goes on to iTunes, even if it's not the podcast app that you prefer, we really appreciate it when anybody goes onto iTunes and leaves us a positive review on there. And it helps us get, you know, a little more publicity, a little more noticed by people, get some more listeners. You know, every now and then we're able to get a new guest that, you know, found us organically. So we'd really appreciate it if you go to leave a positive review. I forget if they're doing thumbs up, thumbs down, five stars, or whatever it is. But, you know, be nice to us on iTunes. That'd be really nice, and we'd really appreciate it. And that's it for this time. We'll see you next week.
Thanks for listening to Thinking Liberty. Subscribe to the show for free on iTunes, Google Play, or Stitcher at thinkingliberty.com. You'll also find detailed show notes pages, articles by Zach and Sarah, and more. We'll see you next time.